3, 2, 1. Greetings, everyone. It's the world's sweetest man, Jervis Cottonbelly. And I'm here with Al and Lexi Lenhart from WrestleCircus and Paul Couture from PowerbombTV. Say hello, everyone.
Hello, everyone.
Oh! Ooh.
Hey.
So now, today we're going to be discussing the topic of piracy. And we're going to give our guests a few moments to join. I'm going to go ahead and tweet out the link. But as we're getting warmed up here, I suppose we could start with you, Al and Lexi. Why don't you just tell us a little bit about WrestleCircus?
Absolutely. So, let's see, where do we start? WrestleCircus, we got started in October of 2016. So, we just had our sixth show. We've been around for 5 months, but we've held six shows. And, each one keeps getting bigger and bigger.
Oh, wait a minute. I suppose, I'm sorry to cut you off, but I don't know that we're actually live now that I look at it. Let me see. Oh, my. Just hang on 1 second and bear with me. I'm still new at this, you know. Oh, goodness gracious. It looks like I may have flopped it a bit. I'm going to go ahead and...
Oh, no.
Oh, no. Well, we're going live again. Sorry to everyone that was joined in. I'm just an old fuddy-duddy sometimes, and, well, you know, I'm not that sharp, so I'm trying my best here with this stream, but again, thank you for bearing with us. We have Al and Lexi Lenhart here from WrestleCircus, and they were just telling us about their wonderful company. Go ahead, Al.
Yeah, so WrestleCircus, as I was saying, we've been around for 5 months now. We just finished our sixth show here this past Sunday. It was our very first high pay-per-view. It was our biggest show yet. We had 674 fans in the building. So when you count all the talent, the wrestlers, and all that, we have over 700 people there. So that was exciting. And obviously, with the cards that we've been having and the talent that we've been bringing in, we've just been getting bigger and bigger. And we have a diehard fan base here in Austin. So everything's been going really well with it.
Oh, I'm very glad to hear that, Al. And, you know, I just have to say that I have had an absolutely wonderful time being a member of the WrestleCircus roster. So I am just very thankful that WrestleCircus exists. And, it's been my favorite place to wrestle since you guys debuted in 2016. So thank you for being you.
Yeah, well, we're happy to hear that. I know that the Austin, Texas fans absolutely love Jervis. And we haven't had a show without you. We definitely don't plan on or intend to have any shows in the future without you. So you've become a mainstay here. And that's why I have my Jervis Cottonelly t-shirt on.
Oh, that's very sweet of you to show your support. I love you very much, Al. Now, Paul Couture from Powerbomb TV. Paul, would you go ahead and introduce yourself and tell us a bit about Powerbomb?
Well, I'm Paul. I've helped build Powerbomb TV along with some other long-term indie wrestling folks that you might know, Adam Lash, someone that some people know as Ben Gerard.
Oh, yes, from Chikara.
Yes. I've helped work with wrestling companies for quite some time. Worked with a lot of them, worked with WSU, Beyond Wrestling. I've helped develop Chikaratopia, and this is just the latest incarnation of my path down, making sure that everybody can understand kind of what that most fun thing you can do, which is go out on a Friday night with a bag of popcorn and watch you guys do what you do, and bring that into more homes instead of just one company on Monday nights.
Well, I like that mission statement, and Paul, you and I have been friends for many years now, and to all my listeners and everyone out there watching the sweet stream, I just want you to know that Paul Couture is an expert developer, and he also is looking to help empower independent professional wrestlers. And the reason that we're here today to chat is to talk about the topic, well, the ever-touchy topic of piracy. Now, for those of you who aren't familiar, when a company such as WrestleCircus runs a show, typically the way that they earn revenue is by selling tickets. Now, Al, Lexi, could you tell us a bit more about how a company like WrestleCircus would earn revenue? Obviously, tickets at the door is one way, but what else does WrestleCircus do to try and earn a stream of income?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, with WrestleCircus, we've really taken the approach, because both Lexi and myself, we work full-time jobs, and WrestleCircus has been a passion project for us. So, the way we budget our shows, or the way that we've been budgeting our shows up until now, has really been to kind of find that break-even point and then manage our talent from there and who we're bringing in. So, of course, we sell tickets online. We've been selling out the past few shows before tickets at the door are even available. So we sell through online ticket sales, and then, of course, we sell merchandise. We have WrestleCircus t-shirts. We have, and then we just started our own video on demand channel at video.wrestlecircus.com. And, of course, we just launched the first iPay-per-view this past Sunday, which kind of brings us to the topic of piracy and kind of how it affected us this past weekend.
I see. Now, just to preface, before we move into the topic at hand, piracy is something that that directly affects independent artists and performers, which is what professional wrestlers are. So that's why we've brought together Powerbomb TV's Paul Couture and WrestleCircus's Al and Lexi Lenhart so that we can perhaps illustrate to fans and to supporters of independent wrestling exactly how piracy affects individuals. Because, as some of you may not have heard, this past Sunday's iPay-per-view from WrestleCircus was pirated almost 6 times more than it was actually purchased. And that had a direct impact on talent and the brand of WrestleCircus and the professional company of WrestleCircus. So before I let you go ahead and explain what happened, Paul, do you have any thoughts just about the topic of piracy and in the overarching scope of it?
Overall general thoughts on it, I understand why it happens. I've been there myself. I've made that mistake.
You mean you've pirated before?
Yeah, absolutely.
Now why do you think?
I think anyone with an internet connection can say they've done that. I rationalized it at the time. As I continued on with what I do now, and got to meet these people and saw the actual numbers of how small, that one person going, gee, I can't buy this, but I can afford to go out and buy a Big Mac or whatever, and they're the same price, directly impact somebody. Because of that, I no longer do it. I think that there's an assumption that comes from that it's on the internet, it's not theft, I can go get it, and it's not going to hurt anybody, someone else will pay for it. It's almost like the bystander effect. You end up with people that, such a large number of people do that, you don't realize how small some of these audiences are, and those things that we love, that we choose to do that with, go away, they disappear, because we haven't supported them financially to be able to have more content generated.
Now, Al and Lexi, thank you for that, Paul. That was very very well put. Al, Lexi, would you please tell us, how did piracy affect the show this past weekend directly? Because WrestleCircus is a very new company. This was only your, sixth event, and or seventh event, rather. And this was the first one that you broadcast on iPay-per-view, so could you go ahead and just tell us how it affected WrestleCircus directly, and what happened exactly?
Sure. So we spent a lot of money getting the technology and the equipment to be able to bring iPay-per-view and video on demand to our fans around the world that aren't able to make it to a show in Austin. So we had a lot of money invested in that. And we pay for the bandwidth to be able to upload it. And so you pay for a certain amount of uploads.
So let me pause you there. So you're saying that you had a certain number of pay-per-views that you sold, and then you were able to pay for a certain number of viewers, right? And Did you have a safety or a buffer zone?
We had quite a bit of a buffer zone, and so if the people that had purchased it would have been the only ones, we would have been well within that buffer zone and not have gone over the purchased amount that we had already paid for.
Now, Paul, do you have anything to add there about the bandwidth size and how the number of orders and purchases affects the bandwidth?
Well, I mean, it's fairly simple to explain. If I can keep my microphone handy. when you're providing video online, especially where you're doing the hosting, in order to be able to facilitate that, you're going to pay what's called a content delivery network, or CDN. And they're going to charge you a certain amount per gigabyte of video that is sent out. So the easiest way to think about it is, let's say you have 10 viewers, and they each watch 1 gigabyte of video. You're going to be billed for 10 gigabytes of video sent out. Obviously, that grows exponentially as the audience gets larger. That cost, it runs anywhere from, you know, a couple of dimes to close to a dollar, depending on who you go through. So your margins are razor thin when you're dealing with that. If you have people using that same stream that are using it that didn't pay to, you know, that aren't paying to offset that cost, you very quickly run up a very large bill because, you know, every one person that you add multiplies by 100% the amount of video you've sent out for sending to one person. And obviously, you know, there are platforms for things to be able to, like we're doing right now on YouTube. But even YouTube has yet to make money because of the expense of how much it costs to send video out. It's still a loss leader for Google.
Now, Lexi, that's what happened to WrestleCircus on Sunday. Is that not correct, though, that you had paid for a certain amount of users, and then you had it was a large percentage that did not pay that were able to access the stream. Is that right?
That's exactly right. So we paid for about 1,000, and we actually had about 20,000.
Wow.
Yes.
Oh, my. Well, no, wait a minute. Before we go deeper, something that I've seen said is that those 20,000 people may not have ever spent the money on the iPay-per-view, but those are actually 20,000 new sets of eyes that got to see the product. Now, those who are advocates of piracy would say that you actually made out by getting 20,000 extra viewers. How do you feel about that, Lexi?
Well, we, of course, would like for everyone to enjoy our shows, but like you mentioned before, there's only a few streams of revenue for us to make for the show. So that was, it's a catch-22 on that. We're happy to be exposed to maybe some new fans or some folks that otherwise wouldn't have heard about us or been able to watch our show. But it's a little unfair to ask us to pay the bandwidth for that, if they're not compensating us.
Now, let's keep that in mind for the end of this session, because what I'd like to do is I'd like to explore more a bit the delicacy and the intricacy of piracy, but then I'd like to maybe come up with a solution that pleases professional wrestling company owners like Al and yourself, Lexi, and streaming company owners like Paul Couture and PowerbombTV, wrestling fans who legitimately pay for the product, and pirate fans who maybe they can't afford the product, or perhaps they're only casual viewers and they're not quite sure if they want to make a financial commitment yet. So I'd like to find a solution that perhaps serves all as best as possible. So I'm glad that you brought that up. And we're going to circle back to that, if that's all right.
Absolutely.
Now, Paul, can you please share, what do you think are the benefits of piracy? Because obviously it's not all bad.
I agree. As I said, I'm ashamed of it now, but I've done it in the past. I'll give you an example. Adobe is dominant in the in the video development market. You know, After Effects, Premiere, many Hollywood movies are now switching from Avid to Premiere. And I think a reason for that is kids who couldn't afford these $3,000 to $5,000 editing suites were able to pirate Adobe Premiere and run it on their home computer and learned how to kind of cut their teeth with that. And now you see that kind of paying off for them. The thing is that, you know, that's a company that could afford to do that, and part of the reason that worked is their average customer was, you know, spending more on their software each year than most people would buy, you know, spend on their first or second car. It gave them an advantage now, but look at how long it's taken to pay off, you know, that, and even there, part of the reason that piracy was an option for that is it was so difficult for a simple billing system to exist. Whereas now, you know, I do a subscription with Adobe, I pay my $54 and change with tax each month, and I literally have access to all their software. There is a benefit to it. It does help you when you get fresh eyes on the product. I think that benefit gets far overplayed, and I think that the zealousy that the RIAA went against piracy in the late 90s, early 2000s, kind of, you know, inflated in people's mind the amount of benefit that's there. I mean, if you have something that literally is selling to millions of people, not only like a music album or something, not only at record stores and online sales, but you know, it's getting played 15 times a day on the radio, that kind of thing. You know, it takes 3 minutes to consume. I think there's more benefit there than there is for a one-off live event. But I do think that the studies and stuff that have been done that make that argument that you know, piracy helps because it provides more exposure is all based on that very small form content, 3 to 5 minute song, that kind of thing. And I think it gets out. I don't think that benefit is there when you're talking about somebody watching a 3 hour event that the reason you're watching is because it's live and you're wanting to watch with everyone else that's watching.
Now, Lexi, now that we've explored the benefits of piracy and how it I also think that we should add something before I go back to you, Lexi. For those of you out there who do pirate shows, I want you to know that this isn't some sort of inquisition, and we don't want to put your back against the wall. As Paul has mentioned, piracy is something that has always been sort of a victimless crime in a lot of ways, and I understand why piracy happens. I'm a bit of a softy, but, you know, I'm not completely empty in the noggin. And I understand that sometimes you can't afford a show. Perhaps, you know, you wouldn't have spent the money on it anyway, and you're just sampling it. I also think it's important to acknowledge the time investment that fans spend on a wrestling show, whether or not they've paid for it. Because even if you haven't spent money and you're actually costing a company like WrestleCircus money, it's important for us to realize that you are giving us your time as an investment and as something that is worth, invaluable. So you give us your time, and that's very important. So I want you to know that, you know, again, if you're watching this and you're someone who's pirated the show, or perhaps you've pirated other things, your viewership is still very much appreciated. And that's why we're going to explore this topic in an open forum, so that we can maybe explore options, again, that provide the best possible outcome for everyone. So Lexi, why don't you go ahead and tell us, now that we've understood the benefits of piracy and why someone may pirate, go ahead and tell us how piracy harmed a new upstart wrestling company like WrestleCircus. What did it do to hurt you?
Well, for us, I guess in the largest scope, it costs us quite a bit of money. So we had to pay for, just like Paul was describing, which he described a whole heck of a lot better than I could, we had to pay for all of the bandwidth for all 20,000 of these already paid for. And so it was a pretty hefty chunk of cash, which can come back in a lot of ways. You know, for a new company like us, we're just starting out, and as Al mentioned, we're just about breaking even on every show, which with this, obviously, did not happen. We were in the negative very greatly for this show. And unfortunately, what can happen with other companies, you have to compensate that somehow, either with increased ticket sales or, which we don't want to do, you know, or additional merchandise, things of that nature. So that's the biggest one is the revenue deduction.
So just to recap, you're saying that you had 200 paid customers on iPay-per-view. You had...
I think we had closer to roughly 1,000.
Sorry, I got that number wrong. So again, you had roughly 1,000 paid iPay-per-view online customers and roughly 20,000 who did not pay and watched the pirate stream. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Now, you've also said that, and this, just so I have it straight, I can't keep my count straight, but this is show number 7, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so this is your 7th show, and on every show, you've broke even, just on ticket sales. You haven't even sold an iPay-per-view. That's on the level, right?
That's right, and we just started doing merchandise at this past show as well.
Okay, so there, if you're listening out there in the stream world, or especially if you're in the chat room, we'd love to hear your thoughts, and we're going to bring the chat room up soon so that we can respond to some comments live. But for those of you keeping track, WrestleCircus has broken even on every single show. The first show where they tried to do an iPay-per-view so that more eyes could watch the show and hopefully WrestleCircus could create a new revenue stream, that was the first show that WrestleCircus lost money as a company. And the reason they lost money is directly because of piracy and the bandwidth costs that 20,000 internet pirates weighed in on WrestleCircus. So I have everything straight. Is that right, Lexi?
You got it, Jervis. Thank you.
Oh, sure. I'm just trying to keep my story straight. Now, Paul, what do you think of those numbers, first of all? And second question, how would a company like Powerbomb TV deter something like that from happening?
Well, on a live stream, it sounds like happened is people shared the link, probably shared accounts, possibly, you know, one person paid and then found the where the stream was coming from, shared it out. One of the things for companies the size of WrestleCircus, for companies our size, DRM is a very expensive solution, and a lot of us don't.
Now wait, before you go with deeper, DRM is digital rights management. Could you give us a quick one sentence summary?
A one-sentence summary is it's a piece of software that doesn't let you use media the way that it could be used on every device out there, with the purpose
of... So it's sort of like a lock for your bicycle.
Right. With the purpose of trying to make sure that you don't share that out and you can't make your own copies, things like that. But it has a lot of bad side effects to it that would... Maybe I can't watch it on my Linux computer. Maybe I can't... let's see, I can't watch it on my Android phone because it doesn't support whatever piece of DRM I'm using. So, you know, a company trusting the audience to do the right thing, especially for such a low cost, it's a risk that they run. But this is the downside of streaming nowadays, is it's very easy for people to, like I said, share that account out. And they think, well, you know, hey, my buddy paid for it. It's just the 5 of us using that one login. But you see how quickly that can expand.
It's exponential.
And it costs you a lot of money. Yeah, exponential. And it becomes very costly because unlike, for example, making a copy of a video, you're actually using, you know, you're not just copying something from the past. You're actually using their bandwidth up that they're having to pay for. So,
and that's what happened to WrestleCircus. Now, I've gone ahead and I've brought up the chat room here, and some of what the folks are saying is they can't believe the number was that high, and they think it's ridiculous that many people stole the product. Perhaps they said that, you know, let's see here, we've got, it pains me to hear that the show was in the red instead of the black. Titian X says, that is a ridiculous number for something that was only $10. Come on, folks. We've even seen some folks say, Tim Smith, for example, says that my girlfriend, put down $25 for each of us to be in the building. And it hurts to hear that others couldn't put down less than half of that to support people doing something they loved. And that's where, Lexi, I want to go back to you, because this not only directly affected the WrestleCircus company, but this affected the wrestlers. And I could share how, but would you like to tell us what type of message you had to send to your talent and your roster today?
Well, we had to send a message to some of our wrestlers. Obviously, this expense was really unexpected. So we had to ask them to, you know, wait to cash some of their checks because we wanted to make sure we had money in our bank account for them.
No.
And then
Go ahead. I didn't mean to interrupt.
So it devalues them and they're so, so talented, yourself included, and we don't want to make them feel like they are less than that, and that's not the reputation that we want to have.
Yes, and I think you've touched on two good points there. Number one being reputation, because as a new wrestling company, you want your roster to have full trust in you that when the paycheck comes, they're going to be able to cash it. Now, Loud and Noxious, who is the host of WrestleCircus and a dear friend of mine, he called me this morning and he said, Jervy boy, have you seen what happened with the piracy? And I hadn't seen the email up until that point. But then I found out that Loudon wasn't able to go to the bank today to cash his check. Now, I don't blame WrestleCircus, because WrestleCircus has always done right by the talent. And I think that the reputation that WrestleCircus has earned among wrestling, the professional wrestling community, is that you have always done right by us and you've treated us exceptionally well, especially when it comes to your treatment of wrestlers versus other professional wrestling company, independent professional wrestling companies' treatment. So it's been top-notch. And for Loudon, you know, essentially, because of these 20,000 pirate streams, Loudon Noxious was not able to cash his check to buy groceries and to pay his internet bill and to pay his water bill and to live his life. So just to recap, again, we've gone from 1,000 paid customers to 20,000 live streams stolen to a company whose reputation may have been damaged, now down to individual performers and artists, frankly, not being able to pay their bills. And this is all as a result of piracy. Now again, if you're a pirate, I promise, the goal of this is not to make you feel bad, but it's to help you to understand how piracy directly affects individual artists like Loud and Noxious, or like yours truly, Jervis Cottonbelly, because I was not able to cash my check either. And, you know, wrestling is how I make a living. This is a career for me, and I want to be able to continue to do this. I know that my fellow wrestlers also want to be able to continue to do this. But if every time, you know, we're on iPay-per-view, there's such a displacement of legitimate customers versus illegitimate customers, if this happens every time, we're not going to be able to monetize our own art and our performance. And sooner or later, there will be no independent professional wrestling anymore. So I'm sorry for that bit of a tirade there, but Paul, Lexi, do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, the other thing that we like to think about is we really cater to our fans, and we want to bring in new talent, new wrestlers that they've not seen before at WrestleCircus in Austin, Texas. And going back to the reputation piece of it, if we have a reputation for not being able to pay our talent, we're not going to be able to get those newcomers in. They're not going to want to come here. So it hurts us all. We're not able to get new folks in for our fans.
Mm. Yes, that's a good point. It really, piracy only helps the individuals who can't afford the show. It helps them to see something that they wouldn't have seen otherwise, or it helps individuals who may not have committed to paying for the show. But it hurts way more parties than it helps. Now, I said earlier that we would try to come to some sort of solution. So, Lexi, Paul, I ask, to perhaps please pirates, please independent artists, and independent business owners like yourselves. What is a good solution for this? Because clearly the RIAA and the MPAA in the United States over the past 15 years have given a very terrible reputation to litigation against piracy. And I know personally that litigation, threats of litigation, that's not the way to effectively quell piracy or effectively cater to pirates. So what is the best solution here? Can you offer up your thoughts?
Honestly, I think it's an issue of education. I think most people don't realize how it actually does have an impact, especially on a niche art like the art that you guys make. And there is that bystander effect, and the best way to combat that and to fix that problem. I don't think anyone that took the time to pirate and watch this stream did that because they don't want to see more of what you guys do. I don't think the vast majority of them realized how much of an impact it has and how it directly affects people like yourself, Jervis, and the other people on the card. You know, just taking that moment and thinking about how much am I really saving? You know, when you spend $10 with a small company, you know, that's lifeblood. You will directly see that. It's not some drop in the bucket. And if you want these things to continue to grow, if you want these things to continue to have more and more events, and you want them to remain at a price that people can actually afford, I think that's something that was touched on. You have to do that by going ahead and supporting them. And honestly, I don't think there's a technological solution to it. I agree with you that litigation it is pointless. It's done more to create an us versus them mentality when actually we should all be working together as patrons of the arts and those making the art to grow those audiences. You know, it comes down to, do you want to, you know, force a company like WrestleCircus to not be able to do live pay-per-views, not be able to provide that kind of content to you, and for the people that are working just as hard as everyone else in this industry, to be limited to just the people that can fit in that building, in front of you.
Now, Paul, Lexi, we've got some suggestions from the chat room, and I want to see what you think about them. Tim Smith has said that, Tim Smith suggested, this wasn't Tim Smith, but there was a suggestion for a donation button on the website, which led to another suggestion for perhaps a name your own price iPay-per-view, in which case those 20,000 free iPay-per-views may have turned into $20,000 or $1 each, if that were the minimum. Lexi, what do you think about that, a name your own price strategy?
Donation button. I saw that on there. Those are all great ideas for sure.
Yes, go ahead, Paul.
One thing that while we're on the topic of that name your own price, you know, there are services in the video game world like Humble Bundle that have done that. One thing I want fans to understand is that can be very difficult to facilitate with your merchant provider online.
Oh, you mean in bandwidth charges?
Not necessarily the bandwidth costs, but the person who the company that will process those card payments, if it's not specifically going to a charity, and even Humble Bundle, who kind of started that, you know, pay what you want pricing model, ran into problems early on, because the payment systems that are out there, they're trying to avoid fraud. And there's not really good pieces of work in play for that. If Humble Bundle hadn't had so much backing behind them when they ran into their problems, that would have actually shut them down. I see that suggestion a lot, but I just want people to understand it's not as easy to do once you get into the business side of who's going to be processing that credit card and allowing that. I do like the idea of a tip bucket, you know.
So a donation button.
Yeah, a donation button. But I just it's not always something that a company, especially, you know, a company the size of WrestleCircus, may or may not even be able to do. That may actually cost them the ability to do any transactions online.
Now, I have an idea. Would you like me to share?
Absolutely.
So I had thought about this. I've been thinking about this topic very long and very hard. And what I was thinking is, what if there were an ad-supported, free solution, or a free stream, a pirate stream, if you will, for the iPay-per-view?
So you're saying...
So in other words, the users who want... looks like we lost Al and Lexi. But what I was saying was, in other words, the users who want to pay for the show can pay for it and receive exclusive extra content and add-on, and they can also receive the satisfaction of supporting an independent business and a small business. But those who do not intend to pay for it, or perhaps they're only sampling WrestleCircus to see if they want to pay for it in the future, perhaps a free stream could be offered to them simultaneously, or perhaps the next day with a pirate broadcast. Perhaps I could host it and do commentary or something along with it, so that those who are planning on pirating it will get to see it the next day anyway. That way we don't lose viewership, and again, it also doesn't affect the bandwidth costs.
The only thing I'd be concerned about there is I like the idea of it being on a delay, but I don't know how much of an impact it would make. I just think that I think the proper solution to the problem is an open dialogue like you're creating between fans. I think if there was a stream, I don't think you're going to get a lot of advertising money. I think that's way overblown in people's mind how much advertising money is out there. But I do think there are innovative ways to get more people involved. I'm sorry, if you don't see $10 as valuable enough to pay for 2 to 3 hours of watching what you guys do, I don't have a lot of sympathy for you. I understand it. I understand why people do it. But I wish people understood how much that small of a donation or payment makes to these companies that don't have a $4 million spot, Mountain Dew spot to hawk on top of charging you for the content. And if you love wrestling and you want to see more of it, there should be ways. There are ways to support the companies out there. I just don't know if there's ever if there's a technological solution to preventing people from sharing an event beyond them understanding that may be the last event they share, because it may prevent that company from being able to put out more.
That's a very good point. And back to our chat room, I'm seeing that they like the club idea. They like the Patreon-style rewards-based idea, and I like that idea too. And I think there's some merit to that. Unfortunately, guests, we've lost Al and Lexi due to a power issue in their home, and they're not going to be able to rejoin us for the rest of the stream. But we were just coming to the close of our stream anyway, and... Paul, before I close with my final thoughts, I'd like to know if you have any final thoughts on piracy, and also if you'd like to tell us about Powerbomb TV and exactly what you offer there.
Well, Powerbomb TV, what we're doing is we have not done it yet. We've done a few live Facebook streams, but we plan to bring live events such as the one that you guys just had to to everybody that wants to subscribe to our service. And we're kind of trying to make it a one-stop shop that you go subscribe to Powerbomb TV. We charge $10 a month. We currently have 15 different promotions. 15 different promotions?
Name three or four of them that we would know of. That's wonderful.
Well, you can find all of them on Powerbomb TV.
Powerbomb.tv?
Powerbomb.tv, yes. In fact, if you give me 2 seconds, I can kind of give you an overview of who's there waiting for you to consume their content and support. And if my computer will cooperate.
Now, while you're looking this up, here are the top promotions from Powerbomb TV. Yeah. Now, this is wonderful.
Right now, we've got Top Row Promotions, C4 Wrestling, Tier 1 Wrestling, Chaos Pro Wrestling. Drove you out to the Midwest for a few shows there.
That's right. Back in 2013.
That's right. NWA Smoky Mountain, we've got Georgia Premier, we've got several Lucha organizations. We've done 2 live streams with Grand Slam Wrestling out of the Northeast. This is just what we have at launch. Our goal is to be a place that places like WrestleCircus can go and say, we want more people to watch our content. We want them to be able to get it. Can we be on your platform? I saw some other people mentioning things like Flow Sports. There's other companies doing this. We're trying to make that a little bit better offering for wrestling, and to basically we're willing to be that one taking the hit. for the promotions to be able to kind of
What does that mean exactly? How do you stack up versus someone like Flow Sports, for example, as opposed, rather, in relation to how you deal with individual promotions?
Well, I mean, what we're doing is we're taking the risk up front for the promotions. Like right now, if anybody that's watching this goes to powerbomb.tv, they sign up, you're going to get your first 10 days free, no charge.
Oh.
Nothing
to lose.
Right. So right now, right, they can go try that. That's not a cost that any of the 15 promotions right now that have content on us has to absorb. We're absorbing that cost for them to have this trial period.
It's very noble of you.
Well, I mean, I think with any video service, you need to be able to try before you buy. To make sure that content works well on your devices, that you're able to get a good connection to the service, and you can watch it, without it being similar to a real player in 2001. You don't just watch a buffering screen.
And you developed the player, is that right?
Yes, we've developed the platform. The other benefit we bring is we've worked with our CDN to make sure that we have the lowest cost possible on our end for providing video out. That way, the money that comes in from subscriptions can go and help fund these promotions that are providing the content, and help a rising tide raises all ships. As these audiences grow, there's that much more content for people to consume, and that much more content, or that much better production values that can be put out. It's a massive expense to get the cameras together, to get the streaming devices together, to be able to connect to a good enough internet connection at a venue. You'd be surprised how many venues that independent wrestling goes into that the connection has to be over a cell phone.
And you offer the ability for any independent wrestling promotion to broadcast live from any building.
Well, yes, that's what we've put together, and we're working on being able to move that across the country.
That's wonderful.
And help. And the other thing is, unlike, it's one thing if you're a single company and you're doing this, but those prices add up. $9.99 is kind of the going rate for wrestling. But the problem is, okay, do I subscribe to this company this month and this company next month, or am I up to pay for five different companies? You know, and then you're back in that boat that before the internet we had to pay for, you know, physical media, and then there was these added costs. So I think this benefits the consumer and the wrestling fan because they have more to choose from, and they're supporting, you know, the different promotions without having to go and have eight different subscriptions or seven different subscriptions to follow what they want to follow. So we're focused solely on being a wrestling provider. We've worked with an independent wrestling for, you know, combined probably between the three of us that I work with on a day-to-day basis, you know, close to 30 years. That's where we came from, and this is a passion project for us. I think the idea is the more you can support things like that, like people were talking about the club, the T-shirt idea. So there's a cost when you start dealing with physical items, and so now you might, you know, maybe it gets you a couple bucks for that, but you've also had to fill a T-shirt, you've had to pay somebody to do that, packaging it, mailing it out, and staying on top of all of that.
So Paul, can I ask you now? What do you think, just from based on the discussion that we've had today, do you think that something like Powerbomb TV is appealing to those who would typically pirate shows?
I believe so. Look at what Steam has done for video games. Piracy was this huge market. You know, every video game got pirated. Steam came around. They fixed the two problems of delivery and, you know, lower cost, because you don't have to put it in a box. It's better for the environment. You don't have to have it sit on a shelf. You don't have to pay a security guard to sit and make sure that it doesn't get stolen off a dock. And they've exploded and almost become a monopoly in video game distribution, because they made it simple for people to go and do what they were going to do anyway, which was download a game and play it. We're trying to provide that same experience for people that currently are having to wait for a DVD or a Blu-ray disc to be made, shipped halfway across the country, put in another package, and shipped halfway back to them.
Thank you.
And make it just easy. It's easy, it's cheap, it's very simple. It's $10 a month. If you sign up for a year, we'll give you 2 months free, and it's $100 a year. And it's focused solely on building wrestling promotions. It's not trying to be ESPN Lite or ESPN Online, which other services, I feel, that might be kind of what their focus is. They want to be kind of a general sports channel. And if they can use some of the money from wrestling fans to do that, that's fine, but that's not their focus.
I see. And this is more, Powerbomb TV is about empowering independent professionals.
Absolutely. So that people like yourself get in front of more fans that would love to see you do what you do with the ring.
Lovely. Lovely. Now I'm seeing that, just a few more comments before we wrap up. Some fans are saying that easier access can prevent piracy. Now, I think there's something to be said for that. And something that Lexi and Al had mentioned to me earlier before they had to drop off, they were saying that perhaps there's a solution of giving away this show on YouTube, because so many people pirated it already. There have been a lot of discussions like that. And I will say, on behalf of WrestleCircus, within the next few days, you're going to be hearing some sort of solution from us regarding piracy, because frankly, this is a bit of a mishap, and it was definitely a growing pain for a new independent wrestling company. But in the future, because of services like Powerbomb TV and because of open forums and discussions like this, perhaps we'll be able to turn the tide on piracy. Paul, thank you very much for joining us. Is there anything you'd like to say before we go ahead and disconnect?
You're a gentleman, and I'm glad that you called and woke me up and asked me to be on this call.
You're welcome. Maybe I'll play you a song.
Pleasure talking. Had a pleasure speaking with you and the fans and Lexi and Al today.
Oh, thank you, Paul. And to those of you out there in the sweet stream land, I'm going to go ahead and share my final thoughts on piracy. I think piracy is bad, but it's not that bad. And sometimes it helps wrestlers like me get exposure and a new identity. But my friends, you must know that piracy must go. Because at the end of the day, we're all independent artists, baby. That was my ditty. Did you like it? I hope
that was,
so.
That was a wonderful ditty.
Oh, well, you know,
we're
sitting here on the beach, and I recently learned how to play Santeria, so I think it goes like this. I need to practice my fingering. I hope Drew Gulak's not watching. He'd be very disappointed in me. Joining us. We are just so delighted to be able to have this topic of discussion and to present it to you here in this open forum. Now, if you're not familiar with me, I'm the world's sweetest man, Jervis Cottonelly, and you've been watching the Sweet Stream. And my final thoughts on piracy are this. I understand that perhaps you may not be able to afford shows or something else that's way more crucial to your day-to-day survival requires your $10, and that spending it on entertainment is not the best idea. I understand that, and I also understand that piracy is not done out of malice. You know, I know that 20,000 people didn't turn on the WrestleCircus stream illegally to hurt the company. I know that at the end of the day, the fans, the 20,000 who watched the WrestleCircus stream without paying for it, they still invested their time in WrestleCircus, and that's very important, and that's still worth quite a lot. So this isn't to make pirates feel bad, and we're not here to put anyone's back against the wall. Really, what I'd hope to do today is to educate and to enlighten others who may not have understood that because of the 20,000 pirate streams on Sunday night, wrestlers like me, wrestlers like Loud and Noxious, we weren't able to cash our checks from the iPay-per-view. And also that for a new wrestling company like WrestleCircus, who has broke even on every show so far, just on ticket sales alone, for them to go out on a limb and to try and bring their product to more people and to show their wonderful, wonderful company to more eyes, it ended up costing them, and it was the first show that they lost money on. And the only reason they lost money is because 20,000 pirates drained the bandwidth that they, you know, they only paid for the amount of bandwidth that was necessary for the paid streams. So again, I hope that's a nice recap of the issue here, but I also want you to know that if you're a pirate and if you have watched something illegally, I still love you very much, very, very much. And we're not mad at you, and I'm not mad at you. We still love you, and if you were here right now, I would give you a big warm hug, because I know that this wasn't done to hurt anyone, but sometimes actions have unintended consequences, and that's what we were here to discuss today. So, my friends, thank you for joining. And as always, when times turn tough, and skies grow dark, always remember and never forget. Jervis Cottonelly still loves you. Fine. Oh, I just want to hug the computer. Come here. Come here. Let's hug. Let's hug. Let's do this. Yeah. Yeah, there we are. We're all hugging right now. See that? Oh, that was a good squeeze. Goodbye, everyone. I love you very much. Mwah.